I sharing this to convey some information to somebody? Why am I sharing? That has to be there. Okay. So if you have found this content to be useful for you or your family, and you are actually exploring it on a regular basis, right? Then you are an explorer. And when you find something useful, you naturally want to share it. So if that is happening to you, then it is useful to share. Then you are not looking for other people. You are not going to look for feedback from other people that how did I go and this and all that. You may look for, points for self-improvement, improvement of the presentation, etc., rather than looking for, anything else. So you are sharing it because you found that something is useful for you and you want to share it with others. Okay. And it is a dialogue and not a monologue. And it is, you can sort of think about it as you are sitting in your family and you are having, a discussion with your, spouse or your children or your parents. All the people are there and you are having a discussion. So your students are like that. Your colleagues are like that. So that's how we are, going ahead with this as a setting. Okay. So as a teacher, you have to be clear as a teacher or somebody who's sharing that the other person wants to understand and can understand, that you have this feeling of trust. You don't have the doubt on their capability that, this is a poor batch or these are good students and things like that. Okay. Every human being wants to understand and can understand. Every human being. Okay. And you have the responsibility to guide, to provide the guidance. And guidance means you are giving them something for them to explore on their own right. Guidance doesn't mean you are telling them answers that they have to mug up, or you're giving them instructions, etc. So guidance means you are giving them something that you found useful to explore within. You found those things that you explored. Some of them you may have found the answers. Some of them you may still be exploring. So those proposals you are giving to the people who have come to the class. Okay. The teacher has either reached the self of the state of realization or is making effort for it. Over here I've written has definite human conduct, has this excellence or is making effort for excellence. So in that sense, the teacher is a co-explorer. Okay. And to whatever extent we have been able to explore and to make our conduct, definite, to live in harmony, to whatever extent that has happened, there is a feeling of happiness, there's a feeling of satisfaction, there's a feeling of enthusiasm, eagerness to share. All that is there, and that is visible to the student. And out of the teacher and the student, the teacher has to have more responsibility, to take more responsibility. The expectation from the student should be very, very small, if at all anything. For example, I keep saying that when we evaluate students, we have to evaluate them on the basis of our own development as a teacher. That if it took me, n number of months or years to sort of get to the feeling of trust, till that time there'll be this irritation and anger and all that. So if it has taken me some n months, for the student it may take 10 times n months. So we have to have that kind of, expectation from the students. So the teacher has to take more responsibility. But the student, we have to be able to show them that, or to help them to understand that it is worth to explore this content, to explore these proposals. So the very important thing for the student is that they have acceptance of the teacher, not starting with doubt, but starting with at least, okay, let's give a fair try to exploring these things, you know. If the student is able to see that the teacher is happy, is fulfilled within, is enthusiastic, is actually doing something with projects, with, you know, whatever they are talking about, they are living, or at least trying to live that way, then they will be very, you know, enthusiastic and want to learn, want to understand. Okay. On the other hand, if they see the teacher is unhappy or is trying to impress me or trying to convince me and things like that, trying to force me, then they may not be very interested in. So they that is very important. So the relationship part, the establishment, or you can say development of that relationship part, is very important. This is the first and foremost thing. Otherwise, information transfer might take place, but beyond that, things don't happen. So when we are sharing also, we will observe each other and we will say, okay, fine, what is the state of feeling of the teacher? And what is the state of feeling of me as a student? So when you are presenting, you assume that we are all your students in your class. Imagine your class and imagine that we are the students, or imagine your family and we are the family members. That might be even better. But we'll be observing these things, you know. The feeling part of it is very important. And are we giving proposals, or are we simply, you know, giving information? So that is one important part. As a co-explorer, so first we sort of have to establish that we are co-explorers by our conduct, rather than keep repeating, I am co-explorer. So you are sharing this as a natural outcome, as a feeling of responsibility, that I came across some nice thing and I'm exploring it, but here it is for you also to explore. So in that sense, we can explore together. You must observe your feeling, if you can, every moment. And whether you are able to see that the other wants to understand and can understand. The other may have difficulty in grasping things. What you are saying, they may not be able to grasp it immediately. So don't expect an immediate answer. And the problem may be that you are not able to explain also fully, give examples and things like that, you know. So that might be the situation also. So keep observing that. And as you observe that, it will help you to pay attention to those things that you have not understood. It will also give you confidence on the things that you have understood. Okay. And these are some common mistakes that we make. So I won't go into that much, because we're trying to just give some brief things. We can go into this later on. But this is important when we, you know, prepare ourselves more in detail. The purpose of this is not to give some ready-made answers, but to strengthen or to initiate this self-exploration in the student. If they are already exploring, to help them to explore more, with more focus. If they are not exploring, they can start exploring. And there'll be hardly anybody who's not exploring, but they may be exploring it in, you know, I would say random ways. So they can start exploring in a little bit more structured way. So that's all that this is very important. Right. Our purpose is to develop the capacity or help the student to develop the capacity to find the answers in themselves rather than to mug up some answers. A lot of our education has to do with, you know, mugging up things and repeating them in the examinations. But here we are saying that they will be fulfilled only when they have the capacity to find the answers within themselves. So we have to help them to do that through the proposals. It's a dialogue and not a monologue. So that we have to be very sure about. Time to time we have to keep asking, okay, even I should ask, is it making sense? Or can you see that? You know, like that. We have to place the proposal clearly. We can't say, you know, long story and things like that. We have to place the proposal clearly, clarify it with short and precise examples, and then place some small proposal, a piece of this proposal, so that the other can explore that part. Okay. And when you are doing that, just check whether you are very clear about the proposal. You have explored it or you have mugged it, so that you can check that also. Okay. And these are some common mistakes that are there. Avoid this evaluation, comparison, making judgments, things like that. They have to be avoided as far as possible. Leave these evaluations to the participant after providing the yardstick. So don't try to come to some things that the human being is like this only, or like that only, or whatever, some proposal, you know. So let them explore some on their own, right? And avoid this evaluation. If at all evaluating, then propose the evaluation, you know, rather than to assert the evaluation. Okay. And keep observing your feeling. Is it you are interested in the development of the other person? So this group right now has 65 people. Are you interested in the development of these people? Or you will say, okay, if they also know, then they'll become my competitors. So what is your thing? Or you want to convince them? Or if somebody is asking a question, you want to make them quiet. So what is that? So keep observing what it is and keep writing it down. If you write it down, it will be useful. And then responding to the questions, this is very important. Listen to the whole question. I've seen a number of people who don't listen to the question and then they start, you know, answering the questions or answering what they have assumed about the question. There's something called active listening. So you might look at it on the internet. In active listening, you try to reformulate the question and ask the person who asked the question that, is this your question? Rephrase the question if the formulation is not clear. Validate whether it is their question. And then give some answer. You know, you are giving an answer. Respond with a proposal, smaller proposal that they can explore. So if you observe any, if you listen to this recordings, try to find out whether these things are actually happening or not happening. And when you present, you observe your own recording also. Check your own recording and see whether, you know, and you can improve on all these things and you can do it. You have been teaching for a while and it will be very fulfilling for you. All these are just pointers to sort of keep in mind. But many of you must be already doing all these things. But we just put them, the important ones here. Okay. And then respond with a wide fundamental answer covering not just what is being asked, but the whole thing, you know. This needs a lot more of explanation, but I'm just giving you very briefly. After answering any question, you must return back to the proposal being discussed. Otherwise, you know, things go from one point to some faraway point. And then if you go to the next point in your sequence, then you may miss where you were. So that is why we do recaps and we keep doing, you know, coming back to the point after every question. So this is important. And you must observe your feeling. When, you know, many people feel uncomfortable when the student starts smiling or saying something or whatever, you know. So you check your feeling, what is happening in you. And also find out whether you are really clear about the answer. Are you able to give an answer in which the student will make some progress on their own right? I mean, they have some proposal to explore and then they will be able to go forward in that direction. So if they have not, for example, understood human being, then we don't keep saying that right understanding, or human being is coexistence of self and body over and over again. We tell them that, okay, look at your needs. Okay, look at your need for food. It's easier to see. Your need for clothes may not be so easy to see. So look at your need for food. And can you find out that it is temporary? Like that, you look at the needs of your body and see whether they are all temporary or not. And like that, you know, so you help them to see things on their own right rather than saying that, no, it is like this only, and n number of people have said it, or we've run it in a survey, or things like that, you know. So they have to be able to see it on their own right. And when you are presenting, you must make preparation. Okay. So you must be preparing, living accordingly. So I'm not going to go into this, but when you are, in a session, when you are talking about the session, the topic of the session must be very clear. Okay. Then each topic can be explained as a series of connected points, isn't it? We are using this method of building up something from smaller pieces. So we are cutting the topic into small pieces, explaining each of the pieces and putting it together. Okay. That is the constructionist approach of sharing. So we do it like that. And there is a holistic approach also, that you talk about various things. And in tradition, we have used that, you know, other approach much more than this approach of splitting it into smaller parts and then joining it up. Okay. So if we have split it into, and in this set of presentations, this is what has been done, that we, each topic is split into many connected sub-points or sub-proposals. You take one point, expand it, explain it, take some examples to exemplify that point, ask questions to participants to help them to explore that point, that sub-point. Then ask them if they are able to see that. Give some time for them for self-exploration. Pause. If there are questions or some clarifications, some observations, listen to them and then respond to that. Return to the key point before proceeding to the next sub-point. So like that, it keeps going on. And at the end of it, sum up the topic, that this is the sum up of whatever we have discussed. These are the four key points that you have discussed. And give points for self-reflection as homework for observation, for self-reflection. So that is how most of these sessions have been designed. And for observations, each of us can, you know, do these observations. that what do you feel the presenter's feeling is? What kind of feeling are they communicating? Are they communicating a feeling of trust, of respect, of opposition, of whatever, you know, domination, etc., whatever, you know, you are observing? And if the presenter is willing to take feedback, then you can give feedback. Don't give feedback if the presenter is not asking for it. Okay. Or you give one feedback, and if their response is, you know, no, I was doing this, defensive kind of response, then stop giving that feedback. Don't go on. So that these observations you can make. Are the proposals placed clearly, or were they imposed or asserted that this is the way it is? Is there a pause after the each proposal? Are the examples that are given to exemplify these proposals or sub-proposals, are they relevant? Are you able to connect? I mean, are you able to sort of more clearly see what the proposal was through the example? And then are the questions helpful for you to reflect? So like that, you can observe these points. And then in the questions, response to the questions, I've written a lot of things, but today we won't do a whole lot of questions. But we'll do this at some later point in time. And here are some common mistakes. So you can see, but let's not go into these things right now. This is whole lot to start with. I don't want to scare people. All this, you don't have to do any of these things, but you may pay attention to one or two points each time, and you may be able to, you know, incorporate all of them at the one shot or whatever. You know, you can take your time at your own pace. You go over these things. And ultimately, the main thing is, if I am very clear about myself or clear about whatever I'm talking about, then I don't need all these guidelines, you know. I can communicate it nicely. So one test of my understanding is that, number one, I live like that. And number two, I can convey it to another person and help them to see the same thing. So main thing that has to be done through all this is my own clarity, you know, and then communicating it to the other person. So it's in that sense very fulfilling for the teacher. They say that to teach is to learn twice. So it's like that. Okay. So with that, I'll stop. If there are any questions, on this, very specific questions, I'll take those.